Hello friends, let us discuss a high yield topic, vitamin B12. Vitamin B12 is unique in many different ways. It is the only water soluble vitamin that is stored in the human body. You know that all the fat soluble vitamins are stored in the body. Water soluble vitamins in excess, they are all excreted in the urine. Okay, but vitamin B12 is the only water soluble vitamin that is stored in the liver, clear? And it is synthesized exclusively by microbes. Okay, it cannot be synthesized by humans. That is why the dietary source is exclusively of animal origin. It is not present in plants. Again, I told you that the dietary source is exclusively microbes. Then how come it is animal origin? The thing is, see, you see an animal, okay, animal has lot of microbes inside, okay, and this microbes, they can produce B12. If you see with this leaf eating animals and all, okay, they have lot of intestinal bacteria, it will produce B12, and this B12 will be stored in the liver, okay, of the animal, okay. So when you consume liver, you are also consuming B12, clear? So in humans, our intestinal length is comparatively lesser, and our B12 production by the our own gut flora is very minimal, okay. Vitamin produced by intestinal flora are biotin, vitamin K, riboflavin, and some amount of vitamin B12. Clear? Rare compound with a direct metal carbon bond. This point will be clear when we see the structure of vitamin B12. So, let's see the structure of vitamin B12. Vitamin B12 contains a corrin ring and cobalt. Okay, CC. Corrin and cobalt. Okay. Corrin ring is similar to your porphyrin ring. What is porphyrin ring? It's a tetrapyrrole linked by methane bridges. Okay. Here, instead of methane bridges, two pyrrole rings are linked directly. Okay. That is your corrin ring. All you have to know is corrin ring and cobalt in vitamin B12. Okay. You know that heme iron contains 6 valences, okay, coordination numbers, there are 6 numbers. Same applies to corrin also, okay, there are 6 valence, 4 are already bound to the pyrrole, the 5th valence is bound to DMB, dimethyl benzimidazole nucleotide, okay, DMB nucleotide. The 6th valence is free. If the 6th valence is bound by water, that will be aquocobalamine. Okay. If it is OH group, hydroxocobalamine. If it is adenosyl, adenosyl cobalamine. If it is CH3 group, that will be methyl cobalamine, CN, cyanocobalamine. Out of this, these two things, methyl cobalamine and adenosyl cobalamine, are the physiologically active forms. These are also known as cobamide coenzymes. This term is important, cobamide coenzymes. What is the coenzyme form of thymine? Thymine pyrophosphate, clear? So, like that, methyl cobalamine, adenosyl cobalamine are the coenzyme forms of vitamin B12, okay? They are known as cobamide coenzyme. Cyanocobalamine is not found in the body. Cyanocobalamine is produced in the industrial process of synthesis of vitamin B12 from, again, microbes, okay. In that, cyanocobalamine is produced. Until unless you are a smoker, you won't have a significant cyanocobalamine in the body. Why smokers? Cyanide absorbed from smoke into the blood replaces the adenosyl group to produce cyanocobalamine, okay. Cyanide is produced during smoking. Smokers, be aware, okay. Let's come to the dietary sources again. It is present only in foods of animal origin. Okay, that too comes from microbes. Plants cannot store vitamin B12. Why? Because vitamin B12 is photo unstable. Okay, when light comes, vitamin B12 will break up. That is why in scientific literature recently, see, photosensitivity reaction in B12 is being reported, because B12 is photo unstable or photosensitive. Clear? Now, we have seen about the dietary sources. So, let us see how it is being absorbed in the body. This is a beautiful diagram given in your Robbins textbook. Let us see this one by one. In our diet, vitamin B12 is seen in the bound form. It is not free. See this. It is bound by proteins. Okay. So, we have to release this vitamin B12. That will happen in the stomach. In the salivary gland, there is production of a protein which is known as haptocorrin. Okay, see the corrin name. It's corrin ring, right? So, haptocorrin. Hapto means it's going to bind. See, we have already seen haptoglobin. Okay, what is haptoglobin? It's going to bind to your free hemoglobin. Okay, that is your haptoglobin. Haptocorrin means it is the one which is going to bind B12. Okay. What is hemopexin? Hemopexin binds to free heme. Okay. Haptocorrin, haptoglobin, hemopexin. Remember this. Haptocorrin binds to free B12. But there is no free B12. B12 is bound by a protein. So, even though salivary gland releases haptocorrin, haptocorrin cannot bind to B12 in the mouth. Okay. So, what's going to happen? When this all goes to stomach, in the stomach, there will be pepsin-mediated digestion. So, pepsin will release free B12. Now, this haptocorrin can bind to B12. Okay, free B12 is bound by haptocorrin. Okay. In the stomach, parietal cells also produce intrinsic factor of Castle. Okay. This is a protein produced by your gastric parietal cells. This intrinsic factor is programmed to bind free B12. Again, in the stomach, it cannot bind because there is already haptocorrin bound to free B12. Okay. So, intrinsic factor has to wait. When this haptocorrin bound B12, see this haptocorrin bound B12 goes to intestine, there will be pancreatic proteases. Okay, your chymotrypsin, trypsin, these are all there. So, when there is digestion of haptocorrin, there is splitting of haptocorrin B12 complex, free B12 is released. Now, this intrinsic factor, this is waiting for so long, this intrinsic factor will come and bind to B12. Why should intrinsic factor bind to B12? Why cannot B12 be absorbed as such? The reason is, B12 is absorbed in the ileum. Okay. In the ileum, there is a receptor complex. It is not a single receptor. It is a receptor complex which is also involved in absorption of other substances which we won't discuss. But I want you to know the name of the receptor. It is a tubulin complex. Okay. Tubulin complex. This again, it is made up of so many components. One of the component is known as amnionless. Okay. That is needed, not needed for you. Tubulin you should know. Okay. Tubulin is the receptor complex involved in the absorption of IF B12 complex. That is very important. Tubulin won't absorb free B12. Tubulin can absorb only the B12 which is bound to intrinsic factor. Okay. This is the importance of intrinsic factor. Clear? Extrinsic factor is your B12. Intrinsic factor is this IF. Clear? After this, there will be internalization of IF bound B12 and all. And ultimately, in the blood when free B12 is released, again there are transport proteins. See, there are so many proteins involved in the B12 binding. This transport protein is transcobalamin 2. Okay. So, this is the transport protein of B12 in the blood. So, we have seen haptocorrin. Okay. Haptocorrin, it binds in the stomach. Okay. Intrinsic factor, it is produced in the stomach, but it will come and bind in the intestine. Okay. Intrinsic factor is involved in the absorption. Clear? Transcobalamin, it will bind in the blood. Clear? Haptocorrin is also known as transcobalamin 1. Okay. Now, let us see the biochemistry. Okay. We biochemists are more important about this portion. Vitamin B12 is required just for two enzymes in the human body. They are methionine synthase and methyl monoanil CoA mutase. I have told you there are two coenzyme forms. Methionine synthase utilizes methyl cobalamin. Methyl monoanil CoA mutase, it utilizes adenosyl cobalamin. There is one more enzyme, leucine aminomutase. This enzyme utilizes B12, but this enzyme is not present in humans. Okay. That is why we say that only two enzymes require B12. But in certain exams, they can also give all of the following enzymes require B12 except. So, they will give this three and fourth some other enzyme. At that time, don't tick leucine aminomutase. Leucine aminomutase is B12 dependent, but it is not present in humans. Clear? So, now let us see the reactions catalyzed by these two enzymes. It is very important to understand the pathogenesis of B12 deficiency. Methionine synthase is involved in the conversion of homocysteine to methionine. Methionine synthase, so it is going to synthesize methionine from homocysteine. Homocysteine is nothing but cysteine with one CH2 group extra. See this, there is a CH2 group extra. That is why it is a homologous compound. Okay, homocysteine. Okay. So, if we methylate homocysteine, see here, we are producing methionine. This is a thioether bond. There is no free SH group in methionine. Okay, there is a sulfur, but it is a thioether bond. Clear? Now, in this reaction, we have already seen that methyl cobalamin is involved. But actually, methyl cobalamin gets this methyl group again from methyl tetrahydrofolate. Tetrahydrofolate is the carrier of one carbon group. Okay. So, the initial donor is your methyl tetrahydrofolate. Okay. And methyl tetrahydrofolate is converted into tetrahydrofolate. Okay. Methyl group is given to methyl cobalamin. Okay. So, now what happens if methyl cobalamin is not there, there will be no conversion of methyl tetrahydrofolate to tetrahydrofolate. Okay, there is no conversion. What is the problem? The problem is the reaction producing methyl tetrahydrofolate from other one carbon group is irreversible. Okay, usually one carbon groups are interconvertible. But only the reaction producing methyl tetrahydrofolate reaction is irreversible reaction. Okay. If methionine synthase reaction is not happening, methyl tetrahydrofolate will keep on accumulating. Otherwise, methionine synthase reaction is the only way of regeneration of active folate. Okay. Tetrahydrofolate. Okay. So, B12 deficiency will lead to trap of folate in the form of methyl tetrahydrofolate. That is why this is known as methyl folate trap. Clear? Folate is trapped in the form of methyl tetrahydrofolate in B12 deficiency. Clear? We will see the importance of this folate trap very soon. Now, let us see the another reaction, methyl monoanil CoA mutase. In our body, propionate is produced from odd chain fatty acid oxidation. Okay, the final step, in the final step there will be production of one propionic acid. And VIMT, valine, isoleucine, methionine and threonine, these amino acids will also produce propionate. Okay, cleavage of side chain of cholesterol will also produce propionate. So these are the three sources of propionate. Propionate is carboxylated by a biotin dependent reaction to produce, it is not even propionate, it is actually propionyl CoA. Propionyl CoA is carboxylated by propionyl CoA carboxylate to produce methyl malonyl CoA. Okay, and dimethyl malonyl CoA is converted into L methyl malonyl CoA by a racemase. Okay, ultimately the enzyme methyl malonyl CoA mutase, which requires adenosyl cobalamine, will convert methyl malonyl CoA to succinyl CoA. This succinyl CoA can go to TCA cycle and it can be converted into glucose also. That is why succinyl CoA is glucogenic. All the intermediates of TCA cycle are glucogenic. Acetyl CoA is not glucogenic. Clear? If B12 is not there, what will happen? Methyl malonyl CoA will accumulate. Ultimately, methyl malonic acid will accumulate. There will be methyl malonic aciduria in B12 deficiency. This you remember. So now let us see the pathogenesis. This reaction and this reaction, these are the two reactions, right? So if these two reactions are not happening, what is going to happen? So we have already seen that folate is trapped in the form of methyl tetrahydrofolate in B12 deficiency. Folate is very, very important for the conversion of UMP to DMP, uracil to thiamine. The difference between uracil and thiamine is nothing but methyl group. 5-methyl uracil is your thiamine. Okay. So methyl donor is your tetrahydrofolate. Okay. So folate is not there. So DMP to DMP reaction won't happen. DNA cannot be synthesized. That is why erythroid precursors, what is happening? The DNA content is more for a single cell, but it is inadequate for two cells. So there is lag in the maturation of nucleus. Cytoplasm is maturing, okay, but the nuclear maturation is lagging. NC ratio, okay, nuclear cytoplasmic ratio. You see that the cell will be very big. Okay, you see in the bone marrow you can see megaloblast. Okay, in the periphery you will see macrocytes. Okay, the nucleus will be big. Clear? So there is ineffective erythropoiesis. That is why there is marrow is hyperproliferative. You will see hyperproliferative marrow which in with ineffective erythropoiesis. Clear? So this produces anemia. Because of ineffective erythropoiesis, you will have anemia, but the cells are macrocytes. Okay, these are the macrocytic anemia. Okay, not only RBCs, even the neutrophils. If you see the buccal smear also, you will see macrocytes. Okay, so macrocytic anemia is there. So this is the hematological manifestations. So the hematological manifestation of B12 deficiency is actually due to folate deficiency. This you should understand. Okay, if you give folate to this person, anemia will be cured. Okay, that does not mean that in B12 deficiency you will just give folate. You have to give B12, because the folate deficiency here is functional folate deficiency. Okay, actual cause is B12 deficiency. Okay, you give B12. And not only hematological problem, B12 deficiency will lead to neurological problem. Clear? That is why we have to give B12. Okay, if you just give folate, this hematological symptoms will improve, neurological symptoms will persist and it ultimately worsens. Okay, what is the cause of this neurological problems? See this. In B12 deficiency, I told you that methyl malonyl CoA is accumulating. Instead of malonyl CoA, this methyl malonyl CoA can go to fatty acid synthesis. Okay, so this is a branched chain, right? So it will produce branched chain fatty acid. Okay, so this branched chain fatty acids, when they are incorporated into myelin sheath, there is abnormal myelin sheath. Okay, incorporation of abnormal fatty acids in the myelin sheath happens in B12 deficiency, and this was said to be the cause of neurological manifestation. But what they have found is there are persons who are having defect in the enzyme itself, methylmalonyl CoA mutase enzyme, B12 level is normal. Okay, in those persons there is no neurological manifestation. So they thought, no, this methylmalonyl CoA accumulation is not a big cause of this, and they proposed that there is reduction of S-adenosyl methionine in B12 deficiency, and this is the cause of neurological manifestation, because norepinephrine to epinephrine conversion. So all these methylation reactions require SAM, S-adenosyl methionine. Okay, neurotransmitter synthesis is affected. Okay, then they postulated this cause. Recently, they are finding that there are some other causes also, okay, which is not required for our discussion. You remember these two causes: methylmalonyl CoA accumulation, incorporation of abnormal fatty acids in the myelin sheath, and reduction in the S-adenosyl methionine levels. Clear? Vitamin B12 deficiency will happen when there is dietary intake is reduced. For example, vegetarians. For vegetarians, there is no source. Curd may contain very little B12. Okay, intestinal bacteria will produce very little B12. So they have to take B12 supplement. Okay, pure vegans. Vegan itself is pure vegetarian. Okay, vegans, they don't take any animal product, not even milk, not even curd. So all these vegans, they are prone for B12 deficiency. Now let us think about the absorption. In the absorption, we have seen that intrinsic factor is produced by the parietal cells. So this disease, pernicious anemia, it is an autoimmune disorder. Here the parietal cells are destroyed. So pernicious anemia, intrinsic factor is not there. Due to some reasons, maybe cancer, stomach itself will be removed. Okay, gastrectomy. So there is no intrinsic factor. So there will be no absorption of B12. Even though the person is taking B12, dietary intake is adequate, but intrinsic factor is not there, B12 cannot be absorbed. That is why gastrectomy will cause B12 deficiency. Any malabsorption state, because in the ileum there is absorption of B12. So if there is bacterial overgrowth, anything affecting the absorption, for example diffuse lymphoma, all these things. Fish tapeworm, Diphyllobothrium latum, this fish tapeworm will take B12. Okay, it's a competitive uptake. Okay, fish tapeworm causes B12 deficiency. Here, so these are all the causes of vitamin B12 deficiency. In B12 deficiency, there will be methylmalonic aciduria. Remember this, it is a question. Methylmalonic aciduria. Hematological manifestations of B12 deficiency is actually due to functional folate deficiency because of methyl folate trap. Okay. Neurological manifestations, we have discussed why the neurological manifestations are there. So this is the biochemical portion of B12, clinical portion and all, it will be discussed in your medicine classes. Okay. I hope you understood the concepts. Thank you.